Hello viewers, welcome to my channel, All Things Spiritual. I hope you liked my last video on Mooladhara Chakra and I hope you liked it. Today, we are going to find about the koshas of the body and why Vijnanamaya Kosha may be very important for our spiritual development. Understanding the five koshas of the human body. The koshas are the metaphorical layers that comprise the human body and mind and house the soul. The meaning comes from the Upanishads, the ancient Vedic texts that informed Hinduism and many aspects of yoga philosophy. Kosha translates to sheath in Sanskrit. According to ancient Vedantic philosophy, the five sheaths provide a framework for understanding the innermost self or Atman, which is Sanskrit for the spirit or soul. What are koshas? The yoga philosophy describes the physical body, the subtle body, and the causal body as three bodies that encompass the five koshas. Yogic theory posits that the human body and the life force energy, breath or prana, is part of the physical body, while the mind and intellect are included in the subtle body. The causal body is considered as the innermost self or soul, which cycles through birth, death, rebirth, and ultimately transcendence according to the teachings. The first body is called the Annamaya Kosha. The Annamaya Kosha is the outermost sheath comprised of the physical body layer, which includes muscles, bones, skin, and organs. Anna is Sanskrit for food, which sustains the human body and keeps it functioning optimally. The Annamaya Kosha is often referred to as the physical body since it is only kosha that is physically tangible. Pranamaya Kosha. The next sheath is the Pranamaya Kosha, also known as the energy body or the life force sheath. In Sanskrit, prana means life force. So Pranamaya refers to the life force energy within the Annamaya physical body. Pranamaya is therefore associated with the breath and the flow of energy through the physical body. The next layer is the Manomaya Kosha. The next sheath of the mind is the mental sheath. It has to do with thoughts and emotions and can be maintained and brought into balance through meditation. The mind sheath governs our thoughts, emotions, and fantasies and is responsible for how we perceive the world around us. These are considered the superficial layers of the Manomaya Kosha. Our mind gives rise to the Manomaya Kosha. The Vijnanamaya Kosha. The Vijnanamaya Kosha is the knowledge sheath. The kosha is comprised of your wisdom, intuition, the highest perception. When you are meditating and observing your inner world, the knowledge sheath is what lies beyond your thinking mind. It stems from a deeper and more subtle layer of self. This innate inner knowing is the higher state of consciousness. When wisdom is accessed, deeper insight can be revealed. Some teachers believe that any activity requiring total immersion, such as playing an instrument, writing or painting, is accessing the Vijnanamaya Kosha. The next sheath is the Anandamaya Kosha. The Anandamaya Kosha is the most innermost sheath known to us as the bliss body. In Sanskrit, Ananda means happiness and bliss and represents the transcendental energy of creation and existence. Therefore, Anandamaya Kosha is synonymous to joy, love and peace. It is total immersion with creation itself and is the deepest aspect of the true innermost self. Just as the five elements, earth, water, fire, air and ether, appear in corresponding subtlety among each of the five senses, so too the intellect cognizes ever subtler causes and effects at play through each of the five sheaths. For example, the Annamaya Kosha, is the coarsest sheath, is based on the earth element, which is guarded by Ganesha. While the subtlest sheath, the Anandamaya Kosha, is based on the quanta ether element and is guarded by the black disc of utter darkness over the sun, which can be removed only by Ganesha. Awareness of the reflection of Atman self within the most subtle sheet, the Anandamaya Kosha, however, is but the foundation of discerning that which the elements, energy, senses and the Kosha serve.
So why is the Vijnanamaya Kosha so important?
The Vijnanamaya Kosha, or the fourth sheet, is the second last sheet, so it means that it's closer to our soul or Atma. Since the Vijnanamaya Kosha is closer to the Atma, the light from the Atma falls onto intelligence, just like how the sun illuminates the moon. Due to this, human being always thinks that his intelligence itself is his Atma. And if you live in this confusion, there is a definite chance that your life might be only unsuccessful. Buddhi has only prepared things to work on once Buddhi feels that it is the one and only. There the ego rises, and it rises to a next level, in the sense that every man has an ego, but this ego becomes fierce due to the concept of me and only me.
Once life carries on under the principle of me and only me, under ego's guidance, then it's a failure for the soul from the spiritual standpoint. This is because you may not know what could happen next, and due to your high ego, the Atma may plan you to be executed in a fashion. For example, a car comes and hits you and you may die on the spot. It's a hit to the ego when such things happen. So you see, it was never the Buddhi, but it was always the Atma that was running the show. It has the power to stop things that are supposed to happen, or may swing things in a direction the ego may not want it to happen. The reins were always in the hands of the Atma. The Atma is God, and those who rely on it will not get hit by the ego, and they will be calm and collected even if a real episode had to happen where your ego was supposed to get hit. The Vijnanamaya Kosha is what gives rise to this Buddhi, and if you feel that this is the Atma, then you probably are disillusioned and you haven't understood spirituality at all. Since Vijnanamaya Kosha is the closest to the Atma at the fourth sheet, it means that it gets most illumination from the Atma compared to the mind, which is the next layer of the onion peel in the certain bodies. So the outcome is that if you use Buddhi to elevate your own ego, then you progress into being an animal instead of going towards your Atma or soul. If you progress inwards, it would give rise to saints, and only saints know that the subtle nature of God, what it's like. They become humble, and human beings don't become humble as they have their ego, which is as strong as a rock. The people who are rationalists, they have a problem with devotion, as the feelings of surrender would be very difficult for such people.
Hence, saints don't fear any kind of adversity. For example, Sai Baba wasn't scared of a gang of dacoits that approached him. People who depend on their intelligence get fear easily. It's due to their absolute reliance on intelligence and mind. This is because Buddhi can only know the present, but it always wishes and desires the future. But the Atma, on the other hand, knows it all. It's able to cross the three bounds of time and is self-existing and self-manifesting. Non-human-like quality, which is generated by nature, and knowledge flows through such a self-existing entity, and knowledge is generated and flows through such an entity. For the common man, on the other hand, it becomes very tough to understand spirituality because he thinks he can get to know spirituality through his intelligence and rationality. And the intelligence that he thinks is the greatest won't ever get to know what the soul or the Atma is like. And the only way to get to know the Atma is through humility and surrender, imagining the greatest vastness of Almighty and bowing down and realizing how minute we are compared to the one that runs the universe. As getting to know the Atma for Buddhi is a difficult task as it is, not attempting to know our real self would land us into a deeper well of confusion, doubt, disbelief, and you would be bonded to being eccentric rather than being fearless in society. Since the person is looking at just his mind-body complex, then fear develops due to the worries about future, and the person will not be able to identify what lies beyond those senses and what is exactly transcending them. Just as the sun's rays hit the water and as the water moves, the image of the sun gets distorted. In a similar way, when the ego rises, it also distorts the Atma's qualities. Since saints always are one with their souls, they don't have incessant thoughts, but they are peaceful and silent in their behavior. The fundamental self-negligence or pramada that gives rise to the appearance of four sheets. What is that exactly?
The self-intelligence is called Anandmaya Kosha, the sheath composed of happiness, because it is said to be the only sheath that remains in sleep. So, it is identified with the peaceful happiness we experience then. It is also called the Karan Sharira or the causal body, because it is what causes the appearance of other sheaths in the entire world, which does not exist independent of those sheaths. Though it is sometimes said that the Annamaya Kosha, which is what is called the Stula Sharira or the gross or the physical body, exists only in waking state and not in the dream state, according Sri Bhagwan Ramana Maharishi, there is no substantive difference between waking and dream. So just as the present body seems to be physical in state, in dream the body we then experience as ourselves seem to be physical. So in both waking and dream, what we are actually are seems to be concealed or obscured by all the five sheets or coverings. Though it is generally said that in sleep we are actually in pure awareness, it is concealed only by the Anandmaya Kosha, according to Sri Bhagwan Ramana Maharishi. This seems to be the case only from the perspective of our ego in waking and dream, because what is called Anandmaya Kosha or Karan Sharira is only our self-negligence or darkness or self-ignorance, and what is self-negligent or self-ignorant is only this ego. So from the perspective as this ego, it seems that we were self-ignorant even in sleep. However, what did not know our actual self in sleep was only our ego. But the reason it did not know our actual self in sleep was that it did not exist then. So since what we experienced in sleep is therefore a kosha or covering only in the view of our ego in the waking or dream, all five sheets appear actually together in these two states and disappear together in sleep. Therefore, whatever person or body we seem to be is packaged consisting of these five sheets or coverings, which appear as soon as our ego rises and disappear as soon as it subsides. Among these five sheets, the only one that remains unchanged so long as our ego survives is the Anandmaya Kosha, which is the darkness or the pramada or self-negligence. And until it is destroyed by keen self-attentiveness, it will always give rise to the appearance of the other four sheets, which are constantly undergoing change. Therefore, whatever person we seem to be in this or in other dream is a very fleeting or insubstantial thing, which seems to be given substance only by our ego, whose nature is to be self-negligent. Therefore, if we truly want to be free from this ego and all its progeny, we can easily dissolve it along with all its sheets or coverings simply by being keenly self-attentive. However, so long as we are reluctant to surrender this ego entirely, being constantly and keenly self-attentive may seem difficult. But by persistent practice, our willingness to surrender oneself will increase until eventually we will let go everything and dissolve back to our source, which is just the pure adjunct-free self-awareness that we always actually were. In those clear view, no ego or any covering ever existed or ever seemed to exist. What do you think about the koshas? Have you experienced your Anandamaya Kosha anytime? Please do let me know in the comment section below. Also, thanks a lot to listen to my video. I hope you liked it. Please let me know if you have any questions regarding it and post them in the comment section below. Please don't forget to like and subscribe the video as it helps the content to move up the algorithm. I'll see you in the next video. Thank you.